Welcome back to Light the Fuse podcast, the only real Mission Impossible podcast. I say that a lot. The only real one.
You're so mean to Minute Impossible.
Do you know about this, Kendra?
Impossible? I've never heard of Minute Impossible.
Let me tell you about these jokers.
What? We're going to be on their show.
I'll tell this to their faces. I don't care. They go through the movies minute by minute. Each episode of their podcast is a minute of the movie. Yeah. We're crazy? I mean,
that's a compliment to them, I think.
I think so.
Oh, my God. Because
they're really diving in that deep.
Yeah.
So there's a whole, I didn't even know about this until I found out about Minute Impossible, but there are all these podcasts about various franchises.
Right.
And all of them do minute by minute breakdowns. And if you listen to it, I mean, I've gotten a lot out of it just like listening. They get to weird details and things because they just pause. They're almost watching it frame by frame.
Yeah.
Finding things. I mean, there's something in the first movie that they caught that I think is really interesting, that Kristen Scott Thomas might not have actually been in the same room when they were shooting that. All of her coverage is separate, and I never noticed or thought about it much. But when you watch the movie, they pointed this out. It's like, yeah, I don't think Kristen Scott Thomas was in the room with them.
Wow.
They always just cut to her over like in the corner by this window, and she's never actually in a shot with anyone else until then. Later, there's a I think it's a two shot with her and Emilio Estevez. And so, like, but maybe they couldn't get all, you know, that whole crew together, all those actors at the same time.
And they pointed out there's a piece of, tape in the Langley sequence that ILM didn't erase from the frame.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, this is the kind of great stuff you can look forward to on Minute Impossible, but...
Yeah, but this is a different Mission Impossible podcast.
It's called Light the Fuse.
I'm Charles Hood.
Charles Hood is here. This is Drew Taylor. We're joined once again by Kendra James. Thank you so much for being here.
Hello.
She is the editor, managing editor of StarTrek.com, so go there. And you also do...
I write. I write everywhere.
Right. You're about to review Aladdin. Excited about that?
Excited is a word.
Yeah. So by the time this episode comes out, you can read her review. Did she love it? Did she hate it?
I mean, you can see my preview of the Prince Ali clip on my Twitter right now. So
okay, yeah, go there, check it out.
Yeah.
Charles, you got to look at it.
Yeah.
It's something else. But today,
I also want to say, I think it's interesting that there's so many connections between Star Trek and Mission Impossible.
Years.
I mean, there were TV shows.
Are you getting in trouble for this?
No.
Okay.
But like they started out around the same time on TV.
On
CBS. And Leonard Nimoy started as Spock on Star Trek. And when Star Trek got canceled, he moved over and joined as Paris. He's the magician who is part of the IMF team in the later Mission Impossible season. So
you need to bring magicians back to the movies.
We've talked about that a lot.
Yeah.
Yes.
Between Martin Landau and...
And
Leonard Nimoy. There's a lot to mine.
Yes. Yeah.
Character.
Well, I think McCrory talked about how he wanted to bring in Paris maybe at some point, or Roland Hand.
Right.
He's talked about it, so I don't know if it'll ever happen. Mm. But also, there's that great sequence in the first movie when Cruise goes around the room with the disc doing all the different magic tricks.
Isn't that a great scene?
I love that. a little sleight of hand.
I like that scene because I know that he spent 6 months like at the Magic Castle.
Oh, yeah.
Like just perfecting it.
Yes.
Yep. I don't know that for a fact, but I know it in my heart.
Yeah. He's probably like a better magician than David Copperfield.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Just from that.
I also love his like V-neck sweater leather coat combination.
His glasses. Oh. His weird wire glasses.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Totally into it.
Such a babe.
I love it.
We're starting off with four. One of my faves.
Yes.
Ghost Protocol.
Well, and you are a really big fan of one of the trailers for this movie.
Yeah, right? the one that's cut with the Eminem song is, I think it's Eminem and Pink. It's genuinely one of my favorite trailers of all time. It's cut so well. Like every hit of every beat of the music is like matched. Like just beat for beat.
And that's the first one that used a pop song in the trailer, right?
And I suspect, and then every trailer going forward has had a pop version, a pop variety. And I'm assuming, and again, this goes back to my whole thing about like directors having vision. I'm assuming that's because Brad Bird opens number four with a pop standard and like a whole fight scene.
Oh, that's so interesting. Right. We just did a whole 2-hour-long episode about the music and we talk about how that is a big moment for the franchise.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is it? Is a ain't that a kick in the head?
Yeah. Dean Martin. Yeah,
it's pretty awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's listen to a clip of that.
The pink song
of that. Well, it's just
if anything's gonna get us taken down, it's the use of this pink song. So let's tempt fate and play this pink song.
It's not Beyonce.
So what happens now? Your mission should you choose to accept it.
So, what's the play?
So there you go.
There you go.
And that was the start, as you said, like the sort of trend, as we'll get into when we talk about Rogue Nation and Fallout, of pop songs being used to cut. And I think some of them even get altered a little bit.
Yeah, for me, this one's the most successful. It's literally just the way it's edited and like how it's not just punches. It's not just kicks. It's not just falling out. It's like this mix of different things that are mm-hmm. happening in time with the music. And it's like, that sort of editing works really well for trailers. It works. There's another cruise movie, Rock of Ages, that I made my boyfriend rewatch it. And there's a scene in that that has sort of the same frenetic cutting, but it's a dance number. And it does not work. Right. It is so bad. It's one of the worst edited scenes I've ever seen shot. But like, it's just interesting to like see how it works for a trailer, because you are trying to hide things. You don't want to give away everything, but mm-hmm. you want to give like piece of the story and get people entranced, but it does not work for when you're actually cutting a scene together.
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, it also has that weird moment where the trailer kind of ends and then they show right. the bird. It's like, yeah. you have to go outside the building. And then that becomes a kind of like second act to the trailer.
And then it brings yeah. in like the actual iconic music and yes. you're like, oh, I'm still here. Like,
yeah, right. Yeah, that part is interesting. I
think it's incredible because it's like, I was in before that, and they're like, oh no, we're not done yet. Yeah. Here's the best part.
Yeah. Well, you had been researching this building since you knew that he was filming.
Well, I remember
that. I remember you sending me.
Yeah, there were like YouTube videos and things of people, you know, filming. I think Brad Bird talked to us about that, how there were tourists down there being like, hey, Tom Cruise.
And the thing is, he will stop.
Oh, like, yeah, I'm sure.
He will stop and like go talk to you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's our hope, is that we won't actually be invited on set, but we'll just happen to be in the same location at some point and say, Tom, right. come over. It's the best we can hope for.
Yeah. We should talk about the posters for this movie.
Yeah, this also
started a new trend with that as well. So this is what we've always talked about, how Ghost Protocol is the big pivot for the series.
Yeah.
Where it really took off. And it's like they've started this also tradition of three different posters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, there's the head-on poster. So this is still his face but selling
the
movie.
It's the first one, right? It's the, right, yeah. that's the teaser poster.
Yes.
And then once you get to the wide release poster, it's like focusing on the everyone.
Yes.
Right, yeah. It's Cruise, Jeremy Renner, Simon yeah. Pegg, and Paula Patton.
And that's interesting to me specifically because like, Paula Patton, Simon Pegg, like Simon Pegg had at that point, oh my God, what is
Shaun
it?
Of the Dead.
Yeah, Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah.
But like, he was not a known entity.
No.
Paula Patton was only a known entity to me because I was obsessed with her relationship with Robin Thicke. But right. like, no one knew, like no one knew who that woman was.
Yes.
And then,
Jeremy Renner.
Yeah, Jeremy Renner was like,
Avengers
was 2012. This is 2011.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So like, who was Jeremy Renner?
Right.
And so like, the fact that they put all of them on the poster, like with him, is kind of interesting to me and says that like, oh, they recognize, okay, let's like,
right.
we got to bring people in.
But also,
yeah, he wasn't a movie star yet, but he had been, I think, Oscar nominated for The Town the year before.
Right.
And he was in The Hurt Locker, which yeah. won Best Picture. But he was kind of more in these
arty.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which was a different.
That has changed.
But also at the time, you know, there was obviously all the stories about them wanting to kind of expand the franchise beyond Cruise, right?
Yes.
So this is also, if you've been following that, seemingly them teeing up that this could be the last one.
Which is,
right.
I was thinking about that earlier as I was rewatching. I was like, it is insane that they were going to try to pivot from Tom Cruise to Jeremy Renner. Because as much as Ethan Hunt does not really have a personality, can you imagine like a Mission Impossible movie that is not Tom Cruise?
Yeah. Well, we can have after these two movies, I feel like he could transition to the secretary role.
Mm-hmm.
So I should say that we have our mascot Nova here is under the table sometimes. So if you hear a dog,
don't get freaked out. There's not a dog in your house or your car on your run. It's on the podcast. Don't worry.
But I was about to say that I think also Tom Cruise could transition into, he could be the team leader without being the point man. Because, you know, in the first movie, they referred to Ethan Hunt as the point man.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. it's like, hey, Mr. Phelps, your point man, as usual, is Ethan Hunt. So, like, maybe he's just not the point man, but he's the leader. He's more of, like, an elderly...
Hands off.
Yeah. I don't know.
I elderly. Think it's possible. I mean, he's like, kudos to him. Again, getting up there, his age spectacularly. Yeah, I don't know how he's doing it. But my thing with him transitioning out is, where are you going to find another actor who's like willing to learn a halo jump?
Yeah. Well, no. I think it would just have to transition to
it's
something
gonna,
else.
It's going
to
be something. Yeah. Maybe more like the old show, more suspense or something. Or maybe, I mean, it'll go to television. Maybe.
I don't know. I cannot believe that there hasn't. I mean, we talked a little bit about this off air, but the kind of acrimonious relationship between CBS and Paramount kind of, I think, is the thing that has kept that from happening.
Yeah, because when we've pitched this on the show before, but like do a Mission Impossible TV show or streaming series with Maggie Q and Paula Patton.
Oh, yeah, running the series.
I mean, I want to pitch a workplace comedy. And just like the sort of background
with Simon Pegg.
Yeah, he could come in and sort of in and out.
All the middle management. Yeah, all the stuff kind of like IMF.
All the people that have to like deal with the shit that
with Ethan Hunt
is doing. Yeah, exactly. Like, okay, we got to pay off the insurance. You know, all that stuff.
All right, but let's get back to Ghost Protocol here. I want to talk about the teaser poster one more time because it's close up on his face, right, with the hood over.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Iconic. The Happy Endings joke. The TV show Happy Endings was initiated Ghost Protocol, and they put the hood up.
Yeah.
So he's got the hood up. But what are all these numbers on his face? So he's got a lot of numbers all over his face.
A movie that it could not be concerned less with, like, technology or, like, anything, you know. And the movie, all their technology is taken away. It's so funny that that's what they use.
I like the poster. I want to.
It's just funny when I see the coding, the
numbers are just a little odd.
Yeah, I guess like a generous reading is that it's the code that they needed to shut down that bomb at the end.
Oh, right.
Like that. I don't know.
That is a generous reading.
Yeah, a very generous reading.
We should also talk about another trend the Ghost Protocol started was they made an IMAX poster.
Yes.
And so they're showing off the stunt of its crews hanging off the side of the building.
That's the best poster.
This poster is pretty amazing. It's,
yeah.
And
we'll post all of these on social media if you follow us on Twitter and Instagram and everything.
Segueing into Rogue Nation, this was like the template for the entire Rogue Nation campaign.
Because they focus on the airplane, A400 or whatever.
Or you remember the motorcycle? There would be those great billboards that were just him leaning in with the explosion in the background.
Yeah.
So it's literally that sort of like template, you know, tenfold or whatever for the next one.
Well, it's because they realize, like, especially because Rogue Nation comes after All You Need Is Kill. So, I think so. Because All You Need Is Kill is like, was that Christmas?
No, that was summer too.
No, summer. Why do I think it might have been Christmas?
No, it might have been the summer.
What is
before.
That? Wait, it's Live Die. No, it's called Edge of Tomorrow.
Sorry, Edge of Tomorrow. Yeah.
But they ended up rebranded it as Live Die Repeat.
Yeah.
Which is on home video.
On home video.
But I think it was first because I think it was on the set of that Cruz said to McCrory,
right?
Maybe you should direct Mission Impossible
because he did a bunch of
Yeah, it was Jack Reacher, which they did. In 2012,
mm-hmm.
and then Oblivion was 2013, Edge of Tomorrow was 2014, and then Mission Impossible Rogue Nation was almost a year later, exactly.
Yeah, and I think Edge of Tomorrow, like, really influenced a lot of, like, what we then saw in Rogue Nation. Like, the focus on the women, because Emily Blunt, like, his interactions with Emily Blunt, like, got so much praise, and the fact that she was, like, the ass kicker and the macho one.
True. Yeah.
And so giving us Ilsa, like, really helped with that. We had already had Maggie and we had had Paula, obviously, but, like, making Ilsa, like, a firm placement on, like, I think does kind of directly come from Edge of Tomorrow and the focus on the stunts, because the stunts in Edge of Tomorrow were blown up, like, to such a proportion in the marketing.
Yes, that's true. Didn't that's do anything for Edge of Tomorrow.
I love that movie.
Yeah.
It's so great. Everyone who's seen it loves it.
Yeah.
I remember the first.
Oh, yeah.
I remember he did like the 7-country like world tour. I sat behind him at the New York premiere on his last stop. Yeah.
That's awesome.
And the final scene in that movie where he turns around and smiles at the camera, I embarrassingly became a 13-year-old again and let out a noise that like I didn't know it was like possible for me to make. He turns around and like makes eye contact with me as I like sink down into my seat.
He probably loved it. He appreciates. If there's one person who appreciates enthusiasm, it's Tom Cruise.
Yeah, I think that's true.
I think so are we going to Ghost?
Well, actually, before we go to Rogue Nation, one more thing that Ghost Protocol started, in keeping with what you said, I think in our previous episode, you had a whole thesis about Ghost Protocol putting a focus more on the team.
Yeah.
They started doing character posters. They had individual posters for Simon Pegg and Jeremy Renner and Paula Patton and the villain and Tom Cruise.
Are they just breakouts of
like breakouts of the main poster, yeah. And they had the different, the no plan, no backup, no choice tagline, I think, or pieces of the tagline. And then if you put them all together, it would make one super mega poster. But that's when they started doing the character posters, which they've now... Yeah. They've now done that with Rogue Nation and Fallout as well, which is like, I think it's, they're figured out what the series is, and that's what they need to do is to highlight everybody team. Loves the team. Everybody loves everybody in the group.
We know that we'll really have hit a threshold if the villain gets a poster.
They do it. They do get posters.
For what?
I guess Hendrix didn't get one for Ghost Protocol, but I know that Henry Cavill and Solomon Lane, what's his name? Sean Harris?
Yeah.
They both got posters for Fallout.
Oh, okay.
I'm not certain about Rogue Nation.
Okay. I doubt it.
Yeah.
Are we on to Rogue?
So should we, let's move on to Rogue Nation.
Go
then.
Rogue.
So there's Go Rogue, which is...
Okay, so we have to talk about the, about the rogueness of it all, right? Do you remember that? So Rogue One came out that same year.
Mm-hmm.
They could not start publicizing it with marketing materials until after this came out. They had they had like a general...
They couldn't start advertising Rogue One?
Yes.
Until after this movie.
Yes.
Wow. Was that like legal?
I think it was more of a gentleman's agreement. Okay. But it was the fact that there were two movies with Rogue in the title.
Right.
Right.
So that's, it's like Go Rogue is so big on that poster.
Yeah.
So that's kind of interesting.
And we're back to the profile, which I don't know if we mentioned, but in Ghost Protocol, it's straight on.
Straight on.
It's the only poster in the series where he's looking straight.
Yeah.
Straight, except for maybe one of the Fallout teasers, I think.
Is that the teaser?
But
or is that the IMAX poster?
This is the teaser. I'm a little confused because this
that's
one.
The IMAX.
Yeah.
There's the one where he's hanging off the airplane.
Yeah.
That's the IMAX, I assume, poster. Which is reminiscent of the Dubai IMAX poster for Ghost Protocol, where it's just Cruise hanging on to something.
And they give away that whole stunt in the trailer.
Yeah.
It's just all there.
But that's actually kind of good that it's the first scene in the movie.
Exactly.
It's like, you're like, okay.
And the Go Rogue teaser, I guess, poster, this is what they did for the character posters as well. All of them say Go Rogue.
Right.
And you get one of Luther, you get one of Simon Pegg, you get this one of Ilsa. I think she's on the motorcycle. So that was continuing the character poster thing. And then there's the main poster, which has this kind of diagonal approach. There's a lot going on. Motorcycles exploding. Tom Cruise in those sunglasses looking good.
I'm kind of into that one.
There are a lot of sunglasses on this poster.
Yeah, that's most of what I'm into.
A lot of Oakley.
Yeah.
Jeremy Renner and Simon Pegg have them too. We'll post this, obviously, on social media.
Listen, you know what this is saying? It's back in summer.
Back in summer.
He's got his Hawaiian shirt
from the car scene. Yeah.
Yeah. And we had your last Mission Impossible outing was Christmas, but we're back. The sun is out and the explosions are fiery and we are ready to party.
We're out running.
We're out.
Should we, so there was a trailer here and they continue the trend of the pop song.
This is used very well. The Fuji song.
It's pretty awesome. So you want to take a listen to it?
Yeah.
A rogue nation trained to do what we do.
An anti-IMF.
Ready or not, here I come.
They're coming after us with everything they've got.
You ready?
Gonna find you.
This may very well be our last mission. Let's make it count.
So what's the play?
You want to bring down the syndicate? It's impossible.
Ready.
So, yeah, that's pretty awesome. They use it really well.
Not as good as the last one.
I still like it. Like, I still definitely appreciate it. But there's another one for this one that also uses a Led Zeppelin.
Yes. Yeah.
Which I actually like more.
Let's listen to a clip of that as well.
Shutting down the IMF is a mistake you may regret. This is Brent.
Go secure.
Go.
The syndicate is real, and they know who we are.
Rogue Nation, trained to do what we do.
An anti-IMF.
They're coming after us with everything they've got.
Oh boy.
You want to bring down the syndicate? It's impossible.
So there's the Led Zeppelin version, which is pretty incredible. I think, yeah. I don't know if I'd seen that until Drew, you emailed
me. I haven't seen it either.
Yeah.
So I wonder if it's an international trailer it might or have something.
Maybe, but I don't know why you would get the rights to a Led Zeppelin song and not put it on a trailer here.
Yeah, well.
Or maybe the rights are only for Europe or something.
It could be that, but also I feel like the Fugees wouldn't play internationally.
That's right. True.
Yeah.
That's very true.
Okay, yeah, that's a good point. And in solidarity with our composer, Kevin Blumenfeld, who did our Legally Dissimilar score, we're now playing clips on this episode, exposing ourselves to legal
ramifications.
Yeah.
oh dear. Since Kevin had the baby, I haven't seen him that much. I'd be willing to just be in court with him, you know, just side by side.
That's a way we can spend time.
Yeah. Catch up.
Yeah,
hopefully our cases line up.
Yeah.
So that we can be in court
at the same time. Yeah.
In court on the same day.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
Yeah. I think it works.
But I agree with you. I think the Led Zeppelin one is really... Yeah. I'd never seen it until just this week.
Those trailers are good. I think that that movie doesn't make that much sense to me still. I know,
you always talk about this.
That one's the least sort of coherent to me.
I also found like trailers 5 and 6, I'll say it again about 6, but 5 I found to be very elegant.
Mm-hmm.
Much
like the movie.
Much like the movie, but I found it was interesting because they don't put any of the opera stunt in the trailer.
They show her with her leg up.
Right.
But
they don't really give you the full scope of what that is, which is like one of the best, scenes in the movie.
Yeah.
In the series.
Yeah.
Yeah. That could also have been, though, because they were shooting that until the very end.
Oh, were
so
they?
So that might have been the only stuff they had finished by the time the trailer
came out. That's entirely possible.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was one where they shot for the entire production. Yeah.
I mean, I think that works to their benefit. Because, like, I was so shocked by that. But not shocked, obviously, by the airplane.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's an amazing sequence. Rogue Nation is great.
It is. And it really is.
Yeah. All right, are we already on to Fala?
Sure. I think so. Did we already look at all the posters?
Yeah, because we have the IMAX posters.
All right. So let's
I loved driving down Hollywood and Highland and seeing that. That awesome billboard of I think they had it was the motorcycle on Hollywood and Highland.
It was with Cruz on the motorcycle on the exploding leaning motorcycle behind him.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
So good. Such a great use of the billboard like shape of using the sort of widescreen.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm not sure which poster happened when or what was, but I know there's the IMAX.
That's
poster.
The IMAX poster. Okay, go back.
So
that's the main poster, and that's the teaser. Poster.
So this teaser poster where it's kind of a silhouetted Cruz walking toward Lens with holding a gun.
Yeah.
With Cruz, another silhouetted Cruz hanging off the helicopter.
Dangling from the helicopter.
You get like nothing out of it. Like, I don't know what this movie is about. Yeah. Which is great. It's fine.
I love this poster.
It's beautiful.
I really want to get this poster.
I think we can probably make that happen.
Yeah.
There are a lot of them available on eBay.
Yes.
I'll probably get one.
Yeah.
But I think this poster is one of my favorite in the whole series.
Again, mysterious.
Yeah.
You don't know what it is.
And I love that they use the landscape of the kind of
New
Zealand
or whatever.
And so it's like his silhouette is split in a way. It's like there's white background and then I can't even explain it, but you'll have to look at it.
That's great.
We'll post it on social media.
Yeah.
It's a really beautiful poster. And then there's the main poster, which
is... this is a mess to me. Like, there's just so much going on in this one. And also I feel like I don't like the shot of he looks almost chunky. Is it just me? Like... I don't love the way he's posed.
Well, if you had 6 other co-stars inhabiting your body, you would probably look, you know.
So this poster's got like, it's an interesting, it's like very saturated. The color is interesting in this poster. And all the characters are inside of him. You've got Henry Cavill, you've got Angela Bassett, you've got Rebecca Ferguson, you've got Ving Rhames, Simon Pegg, Alec Baldwin, an exploding car. Also Tom Cruise skydiving and a giant M and a giant I plus Mission Impossible Fallout. All of this is on top of Tom Cruise. So that's what ends up making him look kind of chunky.
I think there's like a missed opportunity here. Cause like for me, a black and white poster similar to the first one of just like him and Henry Cavill going at it in that bathroom. That's what I want to hang on my wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They didn't. So this is a break of, well, what's the, so let me see the IMAX poster.
The IMAX poster?
The IMAX poster is the stunt, but that wasn't on anything else. I don't think. Do you remember any billboards or anything with that?
I've seen variations of this as standees and stuff.
Okay.
I was in Oregon when this came out, and they had at the theater a standee of this poster.
Yeah,
it's just him on the side of the helicopter, and it's IMAX kind of diagonal, and a different tagline, experience the impossible.
In IMAX.
In IMAX, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this scene, it's interesting because this scene was marketed very heavily, but it was marketed later because of the pause that they had to take in the filming. Because for a while, I remember, like, Tom and, oh my God, what is Ilsa's name?
Rebecca Ferguson.
Yeah, Rebecca Ferguson. They were on Graham Norton in that period where, like, they...
He did press when he broke his ankle. Yeah.
And he, like, went out there, he's like, let's talk about this stunt. And, like, was hammering it on every talk show he was on.
Yeah.
Which was great. I mean, not great for his ankle, but... but, like, great for the movie, because I was hyped for that movie, like, starting in October.
Yeah, I think he did the Conan driving... thing too, where they drove around London. So that was interesting. That is also like such a Tom Cruise thing to do. It's like you're injured, you can't work, but you're still promoting the movie 10 months before it comes out. I mean, it's amazing that he did it.
Yeah. I mean, I'm also just like really glad he broke his foot because he gave me my favorite movie of that year, The Greatest Showman.
What does The Greatest Showman have to do with it?
Well, that's so she left. I believe she left when the foot was broken to go do Greatest Showman
in the break
between when they were filming. So that is like how she got in there.
And she filmed The Kid Who Would Be King on the weekends.
Oh, wow.
So you'll notice that when you see it.
Yeah. And she was pregnant.
And she was pregnant, yeah.
Wow.
A hero.
Yeah. Truly.
Wow.
Should we do the trailer?
We should, let's listen to a clip of the Fallout trailer, which includes that Imagine Dragons song, Friction.
The fallout of all your good intentions.
You had a terrible choice to make in Berlin. One life over millions. And now the world is at risk.
This is the CIA's mission. If he had held on to the plutonium, we wouldn't be having this conversation.
His team would be dead.
Yes, they would. That's the job.
Do people know the story about this version of the trailer? Do you know this, Kendra?
No, I do not.
So
this is from our interview?
Yeah, so our good friend Lauren Balfe, who did the music for Fallout, beautiful score.
Is he our good friend?
I want him to be our good friend.
Do you don't think you could call him or email him for something?
I don't think he would do like pick me up from the airport.
No.
I mean, I wouldn't pick.
Yeah. Burbank Airport, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah. Yes. We love Lauren.
We love Lauren.
So many of what this podcast has become is because of our first interview with him, leading the way to get us Eddie Hamilton, to get us Christopher McQuarrie. Sorry, go continue with your story.
He actually messed with the song to sound more like the Mission Impossible theme.
Oh.
Which is amazing.
We should get that version from him.
I think a lot of people have asked for that.
Yes.
It would be the most I've ever liked an Imagine Dragons song.
Yeah. So he manipulated it to sound more like
the Mission Impossible theme.
Yeah, it's pretty neat.
Mm-hmm.
And so it works. It's a cool trailer.
Yeah.
I mean, we could talk about them blatantly revealing that Catwoman is the bad guy.
But as McQuarrie always said, it didn't matter. It wasn't the point. It wasn't supposed to be a surprise, really.
Yeah. But
and as Eddie Hamilton said, he's got a mustache.
Yeah, he's got a bad guy. He's a bad guy mustache.
Right.
It didn't bother me at all.
Yeah, but I loved it. It was kind of like
when I was watching the movie the first time, it was like, how will he be the bad guy?
Right.
Is he like a rogue? What?
And also, will they go with him? Like, is Angela Bassett in it with him? Is Alec Baldwin in it with him?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. I like that they have the Cavill line about how many times can he be disavowed, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
It's a really nice callback to everything.
Culmination of the whole series.
I remember seeing that and texting you and being like, it's become self-aware. Because it really did feel like...
This whole movie is like sort of like teeming with throwbacks. It's sort of like for everyone, I've said this like your former guest Patrick, I say it to him all the time, like for everyone who was mad about the rock climbing in number two and was like, what does this have to do with anything?
Yeah.
Well, now you understand that he does this in his everyday life, like as an IMF agent, like when he's climbing up the face of the rock at the end of Fallout.
Although McQuarrie said not an intentional callback, and he's not even a fan of callbacks, but he puts them in this one. Is the rabbit's foot's in five?
Yes.
Yeah.
So
he's so good at them. And they never like
slow
down. Yeah. If you don't know the reference, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But again, this shows a lot, but not contextually. So I feel like, I don't know, when you saw the movie, was it still a surprise to you?
I was obsessed. I loved that movie.
I
was the happiest walking out of that screening that I have been.
It's impossible not to just be overjoyed. I feel like especially, I mean, it's so weird too, because we talk about how, you know, it's a little bit darker than the other ones, a little bit more kind of contemplative, but still just kicks your ass and you love it.
I mean, like, for them, like, getting Peg was just such a good thing, because, like, he's just there to punch everything up. Like, I credit most of the humor in the last three to him.
He's great, and I think it's also a testament to Cruise to secede that humor to Peg, to allow a supporting cast member to have those jokes.
He's like a pretty generous, like, I see him as like a pretty generous scene partner.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
Like, over, not even outside of Mission Impossible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Especially because we've heard that, you know, he comes and he knocks out his line. I think they had like 15 minutes to shoot the scene with the guy from American Beauty.
Wes Bentley.
Bentley. Before the light changed or something.
Right.
He just knocked out.
The sun was setting and they had to turn around and get Cruise's. They got, I think McCoy said they did three takes, one where he's like extreme one end of the spectrum, one where extreme the other end, and one down the middle.
All in 15
minutes. That's all they had time to do, was three takes.
Yeah. can I ask my big question? Have we gotten there?
Well, before we do ask the big question, I want to see, do we each have a favorite trailer and a favorite poster?
I feel like I've given mine away.
Fallout teaser?
Fallout teaser, like, one of my all-time favorite trailers of all time, and definitely my favorite of the Mission Impossible, and then, number two, it's that poster, him with the flames. And
I thought Ghost Protocol was your favorite.
No, Ghost Protocol, I like that. I'm sorry, Ghost Protocol is my favorite trailer. And then number two, the poster is my favorite.
Interesting.
With the flame. Yeah.
Okay.
Wait, so which poster?
Number two.
With the flames.
Oh, MI2.
Yeah. To this day.
With the fiery doves.
It's so much nostalgia. Like, that's really what it is. Because I will still, I understand that is not people's favorite movie, but I will still put that on and watch it happily.
Yeah.
There's so many cool scenes. It's shot really well. I mean,
very
a lot of Zimmer's score is awesome.
Very 2000s City.
Very.
Doesn't he have a gash on his face in the poster,
too?
He
does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's like a perfectly placed gash.
It's not like a messy,
What about you? Favorite poster? Favorite trailer?
Poster? I think the trailer for the first one is still my favorite. I don't know if it's the teaser or the trailer. Probably the trailer, because I remember that blade coming.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But that, you know, and I kind of didn't pay as much attention to the later trailers, but I actually love the Rogue Nation IMAX poster. I love that image.
The one with him on the side of the plane.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. So either that or the Ghost Protocol on the side of the building.
Right.
I just love the simplicity of him just doing a stunt in broad daylight. And
yeah.
Yeah.
I think I would go with the Fallout teaser poster. So the silhouette one where he's walking towards you with the.
Yeah.
And then I think trailer. I think I'd go with you too. That first trailer.
Yeah.
Really just set me on this
path. We're clearly older than you.
It's totally.
You know? Yeah. So when we were out 10 or whatever, that was really
13.
13
came out.
Okay.
Or so. 12 when it came out and the trailer came out.
Yeah.
I still have. I used to cut like movie posters when the New York Times would do like the full pages. And I still have the number two poster like in a journal, and I would fold them up in the journal and then tape part of it down so that I could unfold them and just like look at them whenever I wanted to. So I still have my
if
original.
If we come across a Mission Impossible 2 original poster, we know who to
send it
to. Oh, can I also say the Ghost Protocol? I have a poster framed and you just got one too, right?
Yeah.
There was a specialty poster. It's not an official one. Was it Gallery 88?
It was an official. It was sectioned by Paramount.
For the IMAX release?
Yes.
And it's just the Burj that turns into a fuse.
Yeah.
And it's just red.
It's just red.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah,
we'll post that one online as well. It's an amazing looking poster. We'll show you a picture of it in a second. But I have that one framed. I also have a poster, an original Italian poster of the movie release of the TV series that was overseas. So the old show, they turned three episodes, a three-part episode, into a movie called Mission Impossible versus the Mob. So I have that original Italian poster of that.
I mean, this is a lifestyle for you.
It's a smaller poster, but it's Martin Landau and Barbara Bain, and it's really
very
cool.
Like graphic.
Yeah.
This was the Gallery 1988. This was handed out at the Midnight Show on December 16th, 2011 at the IMAX.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and I remember they Paramount did put this up. I remember going to the bathroom at a Times Square hotel, and it was in the bathroom. So the street team had access to this for sure. But now it's time.
Yes, the big moment.
The big question.
Okay.
You're on the spot.
You ready?
Yeah.
Could you please rank the Mission Impossible movies for us?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. From best to
let's least, go from worst to
oh least okay
let's yeah. not say worst but let's say least best to least, best best
yeah
most
least,
best
least favorite yeah. So my least favorite is three. Okay. It never clicked with me. I don't buy him as loving Monahan. Michelle Monahan. I don't buy it. And like part of that is just my whole thing of like not being able to see him as a sexual creature anymore.
Right.
But also I place some of that blame on him. Like I don't think he really sells it. So 3 is my least. 2 is okay. Next, which I love on a personal level just because it meant so much to me. But I understand that it's like just not that great.
Right.
It has Limp Bizkit, so it like it was not going
there's
to
hold a ceiling
up.
yeah.
Next for me goes 1.
Okay.
A movie I totally love, but it's just the whole it's the enjoyment for
okay
me. Okay. After that goes 5.
Okay.
Then 6.
Okay.
Then 4.
Interesting.
Ghost Protocol is my absolute favorite. It's the one where I feel like they're having the most fun. Mm-hmm. I feel like everyone is firing on all cylinders. That team really clicks for me.
It's a great lineup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wish they would bring back Paula Patton so bad. I wish Maggie Q and the skinny Irish boy.
Jonathan Rhys-Meyers.
They work for me, but they don't get enough time to shine. I love the Pope scene or the Vatican scene.
Yeah,
yeah.
But they don't get really enough of that.
And they're totally gone in the climax.
They're not even
in the third act.
Yeah. And so Paula is like critical to the climax of this one.
She has her own arc for the first time. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. And they're having so much fun. And it's the first big, big stunt that we see in a Mission Impossible movie.
Yeah.
And it's done with humor. There's danger, but it's always just, it's funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Brad Bird is like, I would love to be seeing him do more live action.
Yeah.
Because he's very good at it.
Well, he's doing a musical next, so.
Wait, which, I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Which
musical? It's an original musical.
It's an original musical. I don't think the songs were not written by Michael Giacchino, but the music will be written by Michael Giacchino.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's working on now.
That's what he's working on.
Speed Racer, low-key my favorite soundtrack of all time.
Oh, yeah. That's a great score. I have the Mondo vinyl. Oh. Yeah, it's a wonderful score. Yeah.
Yeah.
They have a great... That score, too, for Ghost Protocol, Giacchino's score.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yes.
Yeah, we love Brad a lot. He knows that. He probably would not pick us up from there.
No.
He wouldn't even send his assistant. No. Well, Kendra, from Charles and myself... Thank you so much for accepting this mission.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
And you're for everybody, welcome. So sorry to interrupt you, but for everybody out there, write iTunes reviews.
Yep.
And
subscribe. Like.
Yes.
If you want to throw some money on Patreon, do we have have anybody sponsor this episode?
Oh yes, this episode is brought to you by Jeremy Dillon.
Yeah.
Also check out t-shirts. We got a t-shirt.
Are there gonna be more t-shirts?
Actually, Kendra, you have the t-shirt.
I have 2.
Oh wow. Yeah.
Well, because when you buy white t-shirts, you have to like buy 2 because they're gonna get like all gross.
Yep. Yes.
And
yes.
I want to be able to wear them. So
we're gonna have we have some good ones coming up.
Yes.
I have more ideas.
They're coming slow. We got a lot of ideas, but not a lot of shirts yet.
No, not a lot.
But they're coming.
I would take one with the directors listed in the same
way. Oh, okay. Yeah, we wanna do that. We wanna do the law firm, we bought a sale already.
Yes, we haven't revealed what that shirt is, but it is specific.
We have a lot of very niche things coming.
Yes.
Yeah.
But also, again, we got a lot of bonus content on our Patreon, so, or even if
not
you don't
a lot
sign
of
up,
bonus content, but some bonus content.
There's bonus content.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Well, there'll
we
be
got
more
bonus
soon.
Episodes. We had a whole episode about the HD DVD special features.
And we're
going to
do the commentary soon. It might be up by this point.
Yes. That's at patreon.com/lightthefuse. Even if you don't can't afford that much, even just $1 a month would be awesome.
Yeah.
Are we out of May now? I think we might be out of May. So I think the pod brawl might be over. I don't know what the results
are
yet, but hopefully we won. Thank you all so
much. If we didn't win, we're going
to
have
to. For letting us iTunes, writing us reviews.
Yeah, if we didn't win, we're going to have to like do a.
We have to do ads for the winner, unfortunately. But and this episode is also mixed by Luke Burson. And thank you to Luke.
He mixed the other one too.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah. So we'll be back next week.
Thanks so much.
Bye.
Thanks again for listening, everyone. And before we go, another mission, should you choose to accept it, please rate, review, and subscribe to the podcast on iTunes. And remember that you can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at LightTheFusePod and email us questions or comments at LightTheFusePodcasts@gmail.com. If you'd like to watch the original Mission Impossible television show, all 7 seasons are currently available to stream on Amazon Prime. This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds.